Hello students, in the last two lectures we have seen certain non-standard examples of groups. Today we will see yet another example of a group. So here I have my set G to B, set of 2x2 matrices which look like this. So in our set G, firstly we do not have all 2x2 matrices. I only have those 2x2 matrices which specifically look like cos alpha, sin alpha, minus sin alpha, cos alpha. And you have the freedom to choose alpha. Alpha can be any real number. I mean, for each real number alpha, you will have a corresponding element in this set. We have to prove that this set will be a group with respect to dot. Here dot denotes multiplication of matrices. You can either use a cross or a dot for multiplication. So we have to prove that this set is a group with respect to multiplication, and once we are done with that, we have to check whether this is abelian. So this is a standard operation of matrix multiplication, but then this set does not contain all our 2x2 matrices, so it becomes necessary to check whether this is a binary operation on G. Now, to make life easy for us, I'm going to first set up a notation. You'll see how life gets easier with this notation. I will denote this matrix by A suffix alpha. So my set G now looks like A alpha, where alpha is a real number. So as I mentioned, we will first begin with the closure property, and for this I need to take two arbitrary elements of G and prove that their product is again in G. So now when I take two elements in G, this is the only thing that can change, this suffix. So let A alpha, A beta be any two elements of G. Bear in mind that these suffixes are real numbers. Let us see what happens if we multiply A alpha with A beta. Remember, this is A alpha. So A alpha is cos alpha sin alpha minus sin alpha cos alpha, whereas A beta is cos beta sin beta minus sin beta and cos beta. Now here again, it will be a good idea to pause your video and compute this product. Once you are done, you can continue. So if I were to multiply these two matrices, first row multiplied by the corresponding elements in the first column, cos alpha, cos beta plus sin alpha. So cos alpha cos beta minus sin alpha sin beta, and then we have cos alpha sin beta plus sin alpha cos beta. And here minus sin alpha cos beta minus cos alpha sin beta, and our element in the second row, second column will be minus sin alpha sin beta plus cos alpha cos beta. So let's recall a little bit of trigonometry. Cos A cos B minus sin A sin B is cos of A plus B. So this will be cos of alpha plus beta, and this is like sin A cos B plus cos A sin B. So this will be sin of alpha plus beta. This will be, if you take the minus sign out from both the terms, it's again sin A cos B plus cos A sin B. So this is sin of alpha plus beta. And finally here we have cos A cos B minus sin A sin B. So this is once again cos of alpha plus beta. So this works out to be A alpha plus beta. So A alpha multiplied by A beta is once again a matrix of this form. And notice that alpha plus beta is a real number. So this is again an element of G. So if I take two elements in G and I multiply them, their product is again an element of G. And I have in fact got a very convenient formula for the product. This will be useful to me even later. So this tells me that multiplication is a binary operation on this set. What about the associative property? This is again matrix multiplication, and we know that matrix multiplication is associative. So I don't need to prove that property. I'll directly go to the identity property. Notice that I can take any possible value of alpha. So specifically, if I take alpha equal to 0, I will get cos 0, sin 0, minus sin 0, cos 0, which works out to be 1, 0, 0, 1, which is nothing but the identity matrix. And because identity matrix looks like this, this is an element of G. We know that this is identity. Any matrix multiplied by this will give us the same matrix. But more importantly, we had to make sure that this is an element of G. So this does belong to G. Next, we need to prove that every element in G has an inverse with respect to this operation. So let A alpha belong to G. Remember, that means this suffix alpha is a real number. And if alpha is a real number, surely minus alpha is also a real number. And therefore, if I look at this matrix A suffix minus alpha, this is going to be an element of G. Now let's multiply these two and see what we get. A alpha into A minus alpha. I don't need to go through, I don't need to take all that effort once again to find out what is the product. Remember, I have a neat little formula which I obtained in the very first property. So using this formula, A alpha into A minus alpha will become A alpha plus minus alpha, which is equal to A0, and that happens to be our identity matrix. So this matrix A suffix minus alpha is inverse of A alpha. So for every element of G, and this element is also in G. So for every element in G, there is an inverse for that element in G. So G becomes a group with respect to the given operation. That answers the first part of our question. We would now like to check whether this is an abelian group. What do you think? Again, you can pause your video and give it a thought whether this group is abelian. One may think that this group is not going to be abelian because operation is matrix multiplication, and I have mentioned earlier that matrix multiplication in general is not commutative. However, please keep in mind that this set does not contain all your matrices. So that may make a difference to the commutative property. So let us once again start with two arbitrary elements of G. Combine them with the operation given and see what happens. Again, I'm going to use that formula. It is A alpha plus beta. But here I'm adding alpha and beta with the usual addition of real numbers. Addition of real numbers is commutative. So instead of alpha plus beta, it's perfectly okay to write beta plus alpha, which is the same as A beta times A alpha. And therefore, commutative property is satisfied, surprisingly, but it is satisfied in this group. And therefore, we can say that G is a group, G is an abelian group. from your textbook you will get many other examples of groups. You could definitely give it a try. And in the next lecture, we'll come back to examples of groups, but this time we will look at finite groups. Thank you.